my goodness. A little bumpy.
Number one, this is our
welcome to Lake Placid. We're in New York State, ready for the deciding run, season opening race of the Viessmann FIBT four-man bobsleigh World Cup at the famous Lake Placid track, alongside the action Martin Haven, and beside me in the booth is John Morgan, our four-man analyst. John Morgan, this track has always had a reputation as being tough to tame, and it proved that in the first heat.
Well, we're looking at the German number three team. Nico Walter got his foot hung around the D-ring, couldn't steer one side. Curve three, it was over. But this track is forgiving. It's got a bad reputation, but it does allow the sled to come back up. All four athletes finished in the bottom. They are eligible going the second run. They pulled out.
Third place after the first of our two heats, Alexander Kazyanov of Russia. In fact, he is in joint second spot. He just tied up with a Latvian sled. They are 800s off the lead, he and Oscars Melbardis. Fourth and fifth are only 1600s off the lead. Any of the top seven sleds could easily take a medal. But one man they must chase down first is Max Arndt. The German has a slender advantage, but he is on target perhaps to claim the first gold medal of the brand new four-man season. All the action coming up from Lake Placid in just a second.
Sold at all the order stores, it'll get you into all of the Olympic venues, it'll get you discounts on different aspects of our venue.
Max Arndt of Germany leads a very tight field. 1900s covering the top six, less than a quarter second, the top seven. Oscars Kiebermannis, Stephen Holcomb of the USA, probably out of it that far away from the podium. But we have seven sleds going for three medals. Nico Walter will be not starting this heat. He finished after that crash, got hooked up at the start. He knew what the crew didn't, John Morgan, that it was always going to be out of his control. He just couldn't steer at all.
Well, he had a foot caught in the D-ring, the steering device, and that's not good on this track. There's our leader, Max Arndt, last year's 2013-14 World Cup champion. Did not medal at the Olympics, but there's a guy who was fourth in both the two-man and four-man for Russia, Kazyanov, and one of our favorites to win a medal today.
Yeah, he's right in the hunt. 800s covering the top three sleds. That is less than the blink of an eye. Air temperature rising a little towards the dew point, and the track temperature has come up 1 degree since 7 o'clock this morning. Here is your start list then. Nico Walter and the crew will not take a second run. They're saving their energies for Calgary next week. Edson Binliati of Brazil then will be the first off. They go last to fast in reverse order from their first heat performance. The race leader always last to go. And that means that with both heats counting, Max Arndt's fast first run is not enough. He's going to get a fast second run in because the guys behind are very close.
He finished. He's start number one. Start one for Edson Binliati.
Getting ready for the deciding run to get underway here in Lake Placid.
Good. 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 Good.
Welcome back to Lake Placid. Martin Haven, John Morgan watching the action as Team Brazil get ready to complete their first ever four-man World Cup race. Edson Biliati, Ordelay Pisoni, Edson Martins, and Davidson D'Souza behind this three-time Olympic driver.
Binliati, as you said, three-time Olympic athlete for Brazil in 2006 and 2010, and he was a decathlete 2006.
All these guys look like they could easily be pole vaulters. That's such a tall crew. The average height must be way up to 6 foot.
Oh, same drop! First heat, same exact spot. He almost did that in the first heat. He's learning how to drive these sleds. He won't have problems with the rest of the tracks like here. But if you go back and did a split screen replay of the first heat to the second heat, I'm surprised this didn't happen to him in the first heat.
Nearly came back up like the Germans did in turn nine, but just couldn't get the gravity, didn't flick the sled back up.
Which is even worse. I don't think he'll hit the finish line. The line coming up is right around that curve, and he won't hit it. So it means he'll disqualify compared to the Germans. Well, they pulled out, but...
And the sled will run backwards, so neither Germany's Nico Walter nor Brazil's Edson Bindliatti will be awarded points. The sled runs back downhill. It's uphill all the way to our camera point here, down from the low point in the heart. And
it stopped right at that point where... There you can see one of the athletes. I mean, this is first of all, you get the wind knocked out of you. Second of all, you're a little stunned. I would say in this world of days of concussions, you could say all of them are concussed in one form or another.
Might be a little bit, yeah.
Looks like they're all up and at it, though. I mean,
there's Ordelay Pisoni with his helmet off.
These are athletes. Let me tell you, Brazil has done an awesome job at bringing track and field athletes into the sport. I was trying to tell the story about the decathletes are the best type of athletes for this sport, in my opinion. Devil's Highway, look at him tap the take on, getting in, he's late. Did the same thing in the first heat. He got caught by the bunk in the first heat and was corrected. Here, the track said enough. And look at the spectators. Look, that's almost 70 miles an hour upside down going by those spectators.
And of course, heads and shoulders on the ice. That's why they wear the helmet.
Get in the sled, let the sled protect you. Don't try and eject, that's when you get hurt. You can't practice to crash. You can discuss it with a lot of people. But when you get in that environment, it's so loud underneath that cowling, your athletic instincts take over. Look, all four of them on their feet. Awesome.
See driver Edson walking along the wall with his helmet on his head.
These are tough hombres right here.
Yeah. There is Edson at the back of the group.
Look at him run. Watch him tap the take-on coming in. The take-on's where you get on the curve and then the outlet. He's late coming into the curve. And usually he can get back over. The team can lean to the left and bring the sled back, but it's easier said than done sitting here in this chair.
Yeah, gravity's throwing them out there to the right. They couldn't fight it. As they say here in Lake Placid, John, zigging when they should have been zagging.
Yeah, they'll probably be at zigzags tonight, though.
Yeah.
You know, my heart goes out to the Brazilians. They are really, really, really...
Going to have a short track hold here while they check that everything is A-OK. So we'll take that opportunity to draw our breath, just as the competitors at the top of the hill here in Lake Placid, ready to take on this tough track, will be doing right at the moment. Well, track pause, as always, after a crash. Particularly the foreman, John Morgan, makes a big gouging mess when it comes down. So you've got to make sure that not too much has been knocked out of the wall. Pouring water on it, well, that's going to freeze instantly. The refrigeration keeping the ice mirror smooth here. So they're just filling in imperfections.
You know, the gouges in the track they're going to go check the whole course to make sure that there's not a pressure point where there's a big gouge where you can get a runner in. That could really just pull the D-ring right out of the athlete, right out of the driver's hands.
Working there on one of the
Well, that's where they
fillings.
Exited the sled. That
exactly.
was the end where they yeah. took the sled out a lower point because they didn't get it all the way up to the finish.
So they've got to make sure that is back in position and locked securely.
Look at the curve. That's the famous shady curve. If you go 300 yards through the trees, the original shady curve in the old track exists. They call this one shady too. They've been sliding on this track, Martin, since Christmas Day 1930.
As a few drivers have had a few crashes here in the ensuing 70 years. 75 years coming on, 85 years now. So the Koreans, with an unexpected delay, now...
It's like they're going back.
Back
into the changing room.
Yeah.
So there's their sled, it's on the line.
They were back in the changing room, keeping warm. Especially the driver's visor. You don't want to let the visor get too cold. Otherwise, the moment he exhales on it, it'll fog up and he won't be able to see where he's going. And you know what that means. So these Korean guys Dong-Yoon Kim, the grad student who drives, Kwembo Kim, Kyun-Yoon Kim, and Jin-Soo King. So all four Kims on the sled. And these guys are getting ready. If they weren't nervous before, they will be nervous now.
Touch to clear the track. The track is now clear from the finish to start number one. Start one for Dong-Yoon Kim.
So this is the time, John, where all the nerves have got to be used to try and focus your performance, and especially for the driver whose team are in his hands. He's got to put the fact that the guy in front just wrecked and the guy who was supposed to be in front of him wrecked in heat one, and just focus on doing what he knows how to do. Cleaning the ice out of the spikes. 400 plus millimeter long spikes to give you the grip on the ice that you need to accelerate this sled. Koreans away from the start as the race gets underway again here in Lake Placid. And with the sled immediately before having crashed, John Morgan, how much is that playing on driver Kim's nerves?
Well, you really can't think about that. They've got enough challenges coming down the track to have any cobwebs of anybody else's previous run. Ooh, that's not good here. Go! Two in a row. Exact same spot. And I don't think there's nothing wrong with the curve. I think both times driver in.
There's nothing wrong with the curve. Everybody's been getting around it, no problems all week.
You know, you saw him hit the take on coming in, just like the Brazil sled did. Sometimes you see that, and you hit the take on, he throws you in the middle of the curve. Sled's got no choice but to exit like that. And that's driver error. But you know, he had a very suspect exit of curve two. He tapped the wall out of curve one. Out of three, he didn't look like he had any control of the sled.
It's so often the case on a bobsleigh track, like any other race course, one corner leads so quickly to another. If you get one wrong, corner two is worse, corner three is worse again, and eventually it catches you out.
You know, if you think of it, the Brazil sled came way up and around where the camera couldn't see it. The Korean sled didn't come up as far. I think that's related to the violence of the crash. The Koreans had a harder crash in the exit of seven into eight, and I think that's why they took the speed away. That was a lot harder hit than the Brazilians. Not that either one of them were not violent.
Ice isn't soft no matter how hard you hit it, is it?
We're looking for heads here. We're looking for heads first. Let's make sure these people are okay.
Well, they're all moving and moaning and groaning.
And these Koreans, they finished top 10 yesterday, eighth place, tied the Germans, tied Max Arndt, who's in the lead for today's race. The best finish by the Koreans ever in an international competition. The program is on the rise. A developing nation who really is going to make a statement in Korea in 2018. These four guys we all saw 4 years ago, they were skinny, 18, 19-year-old guys. Now they've lived in the weight room. Look at the size of them. They have passion. And you think how what Koreans have done to women's golf, what you think they've done with men's golf. It's all about paying attention to the sport, and these guys have done it to this stage. Right here, look him hit the take on coming in. That forces, look at their runner tips, way into the middle. Nothing he can do. Now it's just the lights out. He's running the exit of the curve and apples up near the wood.
He ran out of ice. That's the highest line I think I've ever seen there.
I've never seen in all the years I've been calling bobsledding two sleds come down and tip over in the two exact consecutive spots like that ever.
Yeah.
And that's...
I have. Final corner in Winterberg in a two-man race. First and second in the first heat. Both crashed out of the final corner. But that was the final corner, not so high up on the track. That's... And you know, the long wait, the extra hold, the knowledge that the sled in front crashed. He's just overdriving it all the way in there, desperately not trying to make a mistake. And as a result, makes an even worse one.
Look at that. Helmets. Looks like there's still one.
Well, the medical crew
down.
Are down there.
There's still one athlete. He's moving, and there you can see him in. Now they got to really worry.
See, under their lycra, none of these guys are wearing burns vests either. So, you know, you do get friction burns from the ice. You're traveling so far over it, and it's sticky, you know. It hurts. Well, while the medical crew get on with that, we will have another track hold. Making sure that the crew is A-OK is absolutely everyone's priority. We've got plenty of time to get this race run here in Lake Placid. We'll take a quick pause and fingers crossed for our crashed athletes. All right, well, you can see more medical crews going down. So, I mean, the first thing that happens here, you know, your head, your shoulders are getting rattled around. Collarbones, shoulder blades, all that kind of stuff are just so much in the firing line there. You know, you can crack a collarbone, falling off a bicycle, never mind a 70 mile an hour crash in a bobsled.
I just think that they were so, so upside down on that exit. And they had a much more violent hit.
Snowball throwing.
Than we saw previously. I mean, that was really, really the energy. Not the energy you want. Look at him hit the takeout. Bang, the sled got to come to the middle. Now he's got no choice. He was really out of control before this, too. So I'm not saying he had a problem in the steering like Nico Walter did at Germany. But
it's not beyond the bounds of possibility, you're right. I mean, the sled's kind of had a mind of its own there.
If they've got time, if you go back to curve two and curve three, you can see he's hitting the wall up there on top. So unless they did something to his runners that gives him no control, but it's hard to get these four-man sleds in trouble. But when they get in trouble, they like to go their own way.
It's got a lot of momentum.
And there's a lot of, I think that's the driver's head. He's not in there enough. You can get real small in that little cocoon quickly.
The driver was tucked in.
He might have just been knocked out.
I think it's Quembo Kim maybe at two whose head is out most and keeps banging against the wall. The ex-discus thrower.
The number two man is way up. The number three guy. Yeah, this is the
number two and three. They're taking the brunt of it.
You know, in the crowd here in Lake Placid is a little hushed.
Mm-hmm.
But.
Well, like them, like every other athlete here, like everybody watching at home who's got any idea of bobsled, we're just waiting for the news that the guys are okay. The medical crews are all with them. Ben Hefty there, raced yesterday in the two-man, not racing today. And right now, he might be quite glad of that.
Well, he doesn't really like this track for a number of reasons. A lot of people don't, but it's a great track. And both of those crashes were driver error. They weren't related to the difficulty of the track.
It's the finish area. Trucks waiting to take the sleds up and down the hill.
Really, there's one of the managers of the Korean team.
Mm-hmm. You see the track workers again checking the running surface, and they'll be doing that all the way up and down the track as well. And actually, what a great opportunity to have a big hats off to all the guys here at the facility order under Tony Carlino. These track workers. Full week of World Cup luge action last week, John Morgan. Full week of bobsleigh and skeleton World Cup. There is our women's race winner, Alana Myers, down on the finish dock, waiting to see the US teams come in. And Tony Carlino and his crew have been working very hard.
This is good. This is really good to see them people.
A big grimace there. I think there might be certainly some torn muscles, maybe, and you know, ribs as well. Your ribs, your intercostals get busted up pretty easily.
I think it's more of concussion and shoulder burns than that. You know, remember, they just went upside down for about a minute 40 seconds.
Yeah.
And that's a long.
Well, you know, if you have a motorcycle crash where you're on the deck for that long, you're in a really bad way. So hopefully these guys are all A-OK.
Nico Walter.
Track hold still at Lake Placid. Nico Walter there looking relatively happy after his crash in the first heat. He was really cut up about it. The team said, don't worry, we've been crashed by lots of guys before. They're A-OK physically, but they're not taking a second heat here. And since the start of heat two, John Morgan, the first two sleds have both wrecked at the top of the track as well. So we're now in that caution breeds caution period where the nerves get to the drivers And everybody's just got to settle down a little and remember what they did in the first heat to get down clean.
Well, the Nico Walter made him, his mistake was that when he jumped in, the D-rings, which is how you steer the sled, his foot got caught on the right D-ring. He only had left control steering, so he tipped over in curve three. But the next two sleds, Benaldi from Brazil and then Kim from Korea, that was both driver error in the exact same spot of the track, same spot on the track. So, you know, it's human error on all three of these crashes. It's not the track. The track's a challenge, but the track is safe. But you have to learn how and know how to drive.
It's like any other racetrack. It'll have key points that are going to bite you if you get it wrong. Marcellus Brown on the right there from Canada, talking to Jasmine, who finished on the podium. U.S. women swept the podium earlier on today.
Ashley Hayden in the background. She's like the manager of the Lake Placid operations for USA Bob and Skeleton. She's former two-time Olympic luge athlete.
Well, the U.S. women's team got off to a roaring start. Don't forget, next week we're in Calgary, Alberta, Canada, and Jasmine Fenlater will be racing in the women's race along with her teammates, but Alana Myers and Olympic women's bobsled champion Kaylee Humphries will also be in what we're going to have to now adopt the German way of describing bobsled, the four-seater, because it's no longer four-man, because we are going to have the women driving four-man sleds as well. All that to come next week in Calgary. We're still waiting to get underway here again in Lake Placid.
Thank God somebody took them.
We had half a dozen primary schools out watching the action yesterday. Friday, the end of the week after two snow days, they were back in school and out of the track on an observation day, watching the action and enjoying the racing and enjoying the snow. And lots more families out here today. So much fresh powder around this area of the Adirondacks. John Morgan, it's been snowing almost every day all week. Fantastic winter wonderland around here. Well, the jury at the top of the track still receiving notification from the track workers by radio, waiting to get this race underway.
Here's the Korean crash, the most recent of the three. Look at the violent hit into exit of Devil's Highway.
Okay, it's a five-minute warning. A five-minute warning.
And this
to
is 70
Stolner,
miles an hour.
Russia. It's a five-minute warning.
Hard to look at these pictures.
Yeah, doesn't get any better the more times you see it.
Really surprised by the number two and three guy are not in the sled more. They can't pull themselves in. Usually there's a handle or something that you get yourself tucked in there, but they're out and they can't get in. Leads me to believe they might have, maybe one of them was knocked out, because you can get real small.
The problem there, of course, is that you're upside down fighting gravity that's trying to throw you out with every turn, and you're trying to haul your body uphill against the gravity. Malcolm Lloyd Goma, who is coaching the Koreans, is up at the top of the track now, hearing from the officials that they have got all four guys out of the sled. And of course, the first thing in any big trauma impact like this that the medical crews want to do is make sure they're not exacerbating the injury by moving somebody who's got injuries. All four men are now out of the Korean sled. We have a further 5 minute track hold while the medical crews attend to them. The Brazilians all got up and walked away, but the Koreans, I'm afraid it's a little more damaging, their crash. So Goma will be on his way to follow his guys down to the medical workers and probably then into hospital. So the track workers using their shaving tools to try and polish up the surface, take any gouges out, and just some slushy slurry there that they put on with a plastering trowel to try and fill in the big holes. That freezes pretty much instantly on impact. So lots of work going on. Still under caution here in Lake Placid. Track on hold after two consecutive crashes at the start of the second and deciding heat in the World Cup opening race of the four-man bobsleigh season. Martin Haven, John Morgan watching the track workers repairing the damage to the track just a minute or so ago. They moved the final one of the four-man Korean crew out of the bobsled, and that suggests that he was complaining of neck or shoulder pain, maybe cracked ribs. The medical workers down there looking after the crew members will have made sure that they weren't making the injuries any worse before they got him out of the inverted sled.
And up at the top of the track, the Russians are up next. Stolnev and his team, and they've been ordered out of the warm-up shack, and so which means they're a couple minutes away. And this delay has taken a little rhythm out of everybody, but especially this guy here. He knows that the previous two sleds that have come down the track have crashed in the exact same spot. I'm sure he's communicated. In fact, he probably was watching it inside on the monitor. And so I would like to be able to put a little brainwave on what he's thinking right now.
Well, he's thinking, don't crash, don't do that, don't crash, don't do that, don't crash, don't do that. And it's almost going to talk him into having a moment on the same corner.
Well, my point is, too, this track, like it when opened on Christmas Day 1930, this track always had a reputation. When my father, myself, my brothers, we all competed here. It used to be a man against the mountain. You'd get to the bottom and go, wow, I made it down. Oh, by the way, what's my time? On most of the bobsled tracks in the world, you get down and there's a scoreboard to the left of the finish line, and you look up and see the scoreboard. You don't have any fear of crashing. Here, when they come to Lake Placid, it is a man against the mountain, and today, the mountain is won. The last two sleds have crashed, but it's been driver error. It's not because the track is too difficult. These are the first crashes we've seen. We saw 113 sleds yesterday with a combination of bob and skeleton. We saw 22 women sleds this morning. No, hardly any close to crashes.
Nope.
And these crashes here were very much driver error.
Well, in this heat, the mountain's batting 2-0, but the odds are in favor of the drivers. They get the chance to react. All Stolnev has to do, and everybody else, is put out of his mind what has caused this 15-minute delay, and just think, right, the heat is starting now. Well, kids are finding plenty to entertain themselves. Somebody will be complaining of cold feet and cold hands in a couple of minutes. Well, there are the Koreans. All three of them out and in the truck going back to the top, and one still with the medical crew. So our thoughts with him. He is conscious and with the medical crew, and out of the sled. So
it's the main parking lot in Lake Placid. There's about six of these lots. Here's the Korean crash. Hits the take on coming in. I keep saying that. Forces into the middle of the curve on the exit. He run out of curve, so into the next curve, they can't save it. Now, they had no chance. The Brazil sled that came down before them had a little chance on two runners going into that curve of saving it. Here, the mistake he made on the take-on, and this is 65, 70 miles an hour upside down going by those spectators.
Well, the sleds make a very distinct noise as they hurtle down these concrete canals that are suspended above the ground in the way the modern bobsled tracks are. Not sunk into the ground like the old Lake Placid track was, but they make a very different sort of noise when it's not the runners, but the cowl and the helmets that are on the ice.
Well, the personality of the Lake Placid track, well, its reputation was again enhanced.
Okay, Alexi, we're ready when you are.
This is a track that's is running with the big dogs in this sport.
There's some of the track workers that have been keeping this track in pristine condition for the last 2 weeks. Tony Carlino's crew have been working overtime, and what a job they're doing. Ready to go back. The track is now green once more for Alexei Stolnev of Russia, Yuri Selikov, Pavel Utkin, and Alexander Soldatenkov. And for two of these men making a World Cup debut, nervous times indeed. For the driver, all he's got to do is negate the fact that any of this ever happened and concentrate on doing what he did in the first heat, getting them down fast and clean and quick.
The albatross for this Russian team start. He's got the best start so far of the three sleds that have come down, but he is way behind the top sleds.
5:18 start, exactly the same as the first heat. These guys are coming after it.
this is where all the problems have had. Coming up right here. Let's see if he gets in and out of that curve correct. Right here, coming on our screen. Right here, perfect. Look at that. Right through the same problem. Curve 7-8, but not an issue. This is pretty smooth. Now the last albatross coming up right there. That's good. Hard to believe when you hit that hard and I say that's good, but that's the personality of this track. And he's sideways in the chicane. Ooh, a little late there.
A little slower than his first run.
Maybe
that's understandable.
Down.
I don't think the ice is in the shape it was before the 2-3 crashes. 55.79. Stulnev has the lead of the race. He's the only guy to have come down in one piece. 55.41 first heat. We may not see anyone go quicker in the second heat because track, John, the track surface is a little warmer too.
Well, they've had a lot of sleds down this morning, Woman's Bob, and the, you know, the track deteriorates. It's like a, there's no Zamboni that comes out on this track and makes it glistening. Look at the exit of the labyrinth. That's not bad. That's hard to believe we can say that's not bad. Now look at the runner tips here. There's quite a bit of a skid. Look at the guys riding behind him. Look how low his eyes are. All the Russians have their eyes barely above the ploughing. A la Pierre Luters, their coach from Canada. He had that same approach.
Alexei Stulnev has the lead of the race. Cody Baskew of the USA was 2/10 in front of him in the first heat. And he has Carlo Valdez, David Kremen, and Adrian Adams behind him. Just 5'9", Cody Baskew. He's been sliding on this Lake Placid track since the age of 8. Came up the track yesterday with his grandfather, who used to bring him at weekends to Pee Wee bobsled. And here he is, still in his teens, his first four-man World Cup race.
In, down, start time of the first run, 5:16. 13, that's a better start. Cody's like a John Napier was. A kid who was born and raised in the mountain, driving peewee bobsleds. Now he's on the big stage. When you get to this stage, your driving's important, your equipment's important, your start time is way more important. If he ever gets a start time, and to his credit, boy, did he work out this summer. This kid came back. 210 pounds, he probably entered the sport 2 years ago, about 180. A muscle up.
This is a smooth run so far from Cody Baskew. 123.9 at the chicane last time, so a little less speed on board.
Holcomb and Cunningham for the United States coming up later. This is the first of three U.S. sleds, 55.25, and that's 7,700 slower.
That's a good run.
And his first run.
That is a good run. Track surface is warmer later in the day. It's not as fast.
See the way the guys sit up? They're doing that so the brakeman can put the brakes on. It's real tight in that little cocoon that they got to get in. The pivotal part of the track, shady. You want to exit here with a slingshot effect. Look at the runner tips here in the exit. Does he have a slingshot effect? That looks pretty good. Well, he's been down the track a lot, and the kid, he can drive the bobsleigh.
Cody Baskew leads for the USA. We have 12 sleds to go from Manchester in Great Britain. Lamindine, the British Army Guardsman, part of the Royal Protection Squad, guards the Queen as his day job when he's not sliding ice, looking after his crew. Keith McLaughlin, Justin Orocampos, and Andy Matthews on the back of the sled. Coach Pete Gunn. Wife Jackie, former world champion for Great Britain, is watching at home in the UK with their two young kids.
Had a 5:28 start. They should have a better start than that in this run. 5:23. So Cody Baskew is better. Lamont Dean's better. Why? Because it's warmer up there. Less friction at the start. Now let's see if Lamont can get through this curve 7-8 albatross that is taking two sleds down here in the early part of this second run. It's coming up right here. Look, he doesn't get it, doesn't hit that take on. Going in, doesn't push him to the middle, so he gets through there. Exactly the way you should.
Only 300s ahead of Cody Bascu in the first heat. He's 1400s back. He's bringing the margin of deficit down, but he's still in the red.
He's got a 12. He might run out of track here. That's pretty good speed. I think Cody Bascu is going to knock off this British sled. It's going to be pretty close down to 7. Now it's going to get real close.
Could be to the hundredth of a second. They might even tie. 300s back. Yeah. Cody Bascu picks up a spot, and he stays in the leader's box.
Well, Lamondine, he was bringing it back, but his start time, he was...
Little rocky down into the heart, just rubbed off enough speed for him not to stay in front.
Dan Leonard's behind at the start. That's 30 at the bottom, all things being equal. And you got to have a perfect trip down here. And look at the lines, look at the runner tips. And watch the sled climb. And watch how much violence on the left side of your screen. Does he hit square? Ooh, the back end, the front end hits, the back end comes around. That's why he couldn't catch Cody Bascu in the bottom.
Yeah, just a little rocky where he needed to be smooth. Chris Spring of Canada, disappointing run in the two-man for the guy who led Canada's charge last year. He was only 14th. Here he lies in 11th place. A top 10 finish would at least put something into the kitty for the weekend. Alexander Kopax, Derek Plug, and Joshua Kirkpatrick on the sled.
12th best start time in the first run, 5:12, and they did not improve like the previous two sleds, 5:13. And unlike Chris Spring, he didn't have a very good drive down the track, and that wasn't a very good exit of curve 3. This is when you want to let the sled accelerate. It has not reached maximum speed yet. Boy, he's starting to let it fly now. That's good exit out of Shady. It's good speed. Ooh. Good speed. That's a good line. But it's down to 1000s. Martin, this could be close.
Cody Bascu might just hang on. 700s of a second. It's going to be close at the line. Will Spring have the lead? He does not. 100th behind. Bascu and the crew lead for the USA with 10 to go. A 100th of a second may just have denied Chris Spring a shot at a top 10 finish. Cody Bascu holds a slender margin.
Mistake up at the top of the track. Look at this curve 3. Look at him. You can't do this up here. It's hard to get these big four-mans in trouble. But when you do, it's hard to bring them back. And, you know, with the deficient start time, you can't make any mistakes. You got to come down and hit a home run, which he has the ability to. He's a great driver. He didn't do it on either one of those two heats.
Well, Springer, the standout driver for Canada the last couple of seasons, eclipsed Lyndon Rush. Now he's got Justin Cripps snapping at his heels, and in fact, in front of him in this race, as in the two-man.
Good. Good.
Switzerland's Rico Pater, 10th after the first of our two heats here. Brohr van der Zijde, Thomas Amrine, Simon Friedli, the rest of the four-man crew. And the only Swiss sled in the competition. Had a good run in the two-man race yesterday to sixth spot. Rico Pater could add more points to the four-man pile with a good drive here.
Very impressive start time in the first run. Top four.
5:00.06, a big getaway, 5:07.
Speed on the left, that marker right there on the left, 54.3 miles per hour, or kilometers, that's 33.8 miles an hour. That's a good box score. If you've got a great speed there, that means you all entered the sled well. He had a big lead in the first run at the top of the track, a little bit at start time, but Martin, he gave it all the way in the bottom.
Yes, he did. Now he needs to tidy it up once he gets out of the chicane. Good speed, 116.5, 72.4 miles an hour. shoots the chicane beautifully, 123.8, and he's going to keep all that speed and add to it.
This is a good run. Rico Peters starting to become impressive. Start time, I'm really impressed with. Didn't do bad, the two man. 4,800, 55.06.
Well, that's slower than his first heat by a quarter of a second, yeah. Very good run from Rico Peter. Guarantees a top 10 finish. Well, there is Bernd Hefti, who raced in the two-man yesterday for Switzerland.
Okay, it's all about the start. Okay, this is the 50-meter start. The 50-meter starts right about now. 50 meters later, that's when you clock your speed at that point. But when you enter the sled right here and how you sit down, this tells you how much, how a good start technique that you had. Getting in the sled, getting around the first curve without altering that. If I have a choice of the best start time or the best speed at 100 meters, I'll take the 100 meter speed all day.
Rico Peter leads by nearly half a second from Chris Brancodi, Basque, third and second. We have nine to go here in Lake Placid. Next up, a man whose team have for so many years been used to getting in very quickly and getting settled, but it's a new lineup. Justin Olsen remains from the 19 crew behind Stephen Holcomb, but Alex Harrison, Aaron Victorian are new to this team.
Yeah, Holcomb didn't have a very good start. Speed, look at that, 54.1, 33.7 miles per hour. That load wasn't good. You know, this might be a little post-Olympic blues for Steve Holcomb, which he had in the 2010-11 season. He was a little bit of a slump then. And brand new crew, and the guy in the back, Arian Victorian, he's from Hawaii. He's got brand new guys, except for Justin Olsen.
Well, Kurt Tomasevic, Steve Langton are both here. Spoke to Kurt last night. He said, I could not have kept the body going for another 4 years, and that's why we're getting the big change around now.
Great speed.
Fastest man through the chicane, keeping a slender lead alive over Rico Peter to the line, maybe a tenth in front, not even. 55.01, 500's quicker than Rico Peter. Both runs added together, the least elapsed time will be the winner. The night train pulls into the station. The livery and the driver are the same, but some of the engineers are different.
You know, the start in bobsledding is about, it epitomizes a team sport. And these guys are all brand new. They've got about 50 trips with each other. And watch the left side. This is not easy getting in. You don't know each other, the timing. You need hundreds of trips in the summer to perfect that. And these guys are just brand new.
And this is day one of 4 years running up to Pyeongchang in the next Winter Olympics. Holcomb's not fretting the small stuff yet. Next up, eighth after the first heat, 1/100th of a second in front of Stephen Holcomb, Oscars Kiebermanis of Latvia. And this guy started 5:08, identical time to Holke, just 1/100th between them in a mile of ice. What's the gap going to be after 2 miles of ice?
This guy 2 years ago was just started driving bobsleds. You talk about an acceleration curve. They've put him in the front seat of a bobsled because of his athleticism. And like his teammate Mel Bartis coming up, this guy's got a bright future. See that clock on the right? Well, that's the 30 seconds they have. They have a minute to go. A lot of teams take the full minute. This team decided Kiebermanis to take off as soon as they could. 5:08, exact same start as they had the first one. Listen to the sound. Watch the heads. See those heads snapping, coming on off the curve. That's bad transition. It's almost a dead heat with Holcomb. Holcomb at 125 kilometer speed on the left side. That'll tell it all right here.
100th of a second.
Oh, way out, way out.
Big skid there means he's not going to stay in front. Stephen Holcomb and the crew will move up at least one spot. Kiebermanis down in third at the moment. Might drop to fourth behind Cody Basque. Fourth at the line, tied with Basque. Holcomb leads for the USA with seven sleds still to go here in Lake Placid.
Well,
So Steve Holcomb is the race leader. Rico Pater in second place because Oscar's keeper Manis couldn't hold it together. The chicane is what was the final nail in the coffin, John Morgan.
Well, that he already had bad speed, but that exit, look at Sadler's Prusis, the coach. The school's still out on his driving ability, but I still like the chances for this young Oscar's keeper Manis from Latvia.
He didn't even go to the last games. He wasn't even a brakeman then, and since then he's been a brakeman, become a driver. He's got a lot of learning still in him. Germany's Francesco Friedrich, seventh after the first heat. Yesterday's two-man race winner. Can he break into the medals? Probably not, but he's got a shot.
Jan Martin Thorsten, are his push arms there. Into curve one, their start time 5.2. They're going to need a
Martin Haven, John Morgan in Lake Placid, watching the action. Francesco Friedrich, Germany's bright young star in two-man, won yesterday, seventh after heat one, chasing after Stephen Holcomb. Oh, and he crashes!
Amazing. This is just unbelievable. That's on the 100 meters down where the other two sleds crashed. And this is where his teammate, Max Arndt, crashed earlier in the week. So all three German sleds have crashed this week. Two of them in today's competition. Shocked. Never seen anything like this in my long career covering the sport.
Well, the track is super fast this morning. Talking to a couple of guys that took a track work early on, they were saying, whoa, they got on the track at the top, started walking down in their spikes.
But look at where that sled went compared to the Brazil sled. That's because they crashed at a lower spot and they didn't have a hard, hard hit like the Brazilians or the Koreans.
And that means he will get World Cup points. He has finished the race. It wasn't anything other than ugly and painful, but it is a finish. He crosses the finish line. He will score.
Great point. 7 seconds behind, but it's the World Cup points. Now it's about getting all four athletes up, but that was not a violent crash like the Brazilian or the Korean crash.
Well, he'll finish in 14th place, no worse. And again, look at the track workers. They're all working spikes. And my point this morning, this track is super fast today.
It's not record speed fast, but it's slick. Crossover, this is where the Brazil and Korean sleds crashed. What happens here? He gets on too early? Wow! I haven't seen too many of those lines. Usually you roll into the curve or you come out too late. He looked like he was right in the middle of the curve.
He had the same crash. He was just going quicker. It happened later up the turn rather than going into it. Yeah.
No, he crashed in the curve eight.
Yeah.
Nine, but I really didn't understand that line because the Korean and Brazil both made the mistake of hitting the take on before they got in the curve. Look at those pictures.
The track today is not the track they trained on. It is much harder, much faster, and that's the difference.
Martin, I can't totally agree with you. I think it's the similar speeds that they had.
I'm just a little
perplexed.
Feel.
You know, it's they trained at this time. This is the time they were training from 2 o'clock to 4 o'clock all week. So, and the conditions were snowy all week long, but the track's got a roof on it.
But don't forget, it snowed all night during the week. Last night, it got down below minus 10, so the track was much harder, much slicker this morning. Everybody who took a track walk knew that. But, you know, he survived heat two. He got down clean. He was chasing after it. And that's what happens. You've got to push right for every hundredth of a second.
I'm perplexed. There's something wrong. He's only young, 24-year-old, who won the race. That guy won the race yesterday. Okay, we aren't talking about a developing driver. We're talking about somebody who won the race yesterday. So that the ongoing conversation about man against the mountain in Lake Placid, well, it's the mountain is winning today. So look at all the grooves.
Yeah, he was getting after it. He's like the quarterback trying to drill that pass that gets picked off. You're working with hundreds of a second, with fractions of an inch, and sometimes the balance goes against you. And he was chasing a position, and it got away from him.
Now there's conversations going on amongst the jury, and I'm sure there's some coaches barking at him. The track's not safe. The guy who won yesterday crashed. The Brazil and Koreans are one thing. They're developing nation guys, and they both made big-time driver errors.
Well, the USA lead at the moment, but if the heat is called off, it will be Germany who take the victory because it'll be decided on the first round. Stephen Holcomb leads from Enrico Pater. Cody Baskew lies third ahead of Oscars Kibermanis and Chris Spring. And we still have six to get down here in Lake Placid.
Time of 149.87. This is the final competition for the FIBT World Cup event.
Well, the conspiracy theorists among you would be saying that right now, Christoph Langen, the German coach, is up at the top hectoring the jury to get the race called off. Both of his sleds have crashed so far in Heat 1 and in Heat 2. And Max Arndt leads after Heat 1. For Germany, if they get it called, Arndt is a sealed-in winner. However, if they don't get the race called off, Arndt might crash. You might have Christoph Langer with all three sleds going over in this race. That's not beyond the bounds of possibility.
And Max Arndt did crash earlier in the week in practice, I think on Tuesday, which was maybe Wednesday. Very surprising to see a guy. Now here's the jury. And on the jury, it's Manfred Schulte. Celebrated a birthday a couple days ago. He's the head jury meister, and he's talking to the officials down the track who are looking at all the grooves in the track. And Pierre Luters here at the start, standing right behind him. I'm sure Pierre Luters already barked a couple orders.
Yeah, but he's ready for his crew to go down. Holcomb talking through how the accident happened.
Same thing 4 years and 5 years ago. Just tips over in the middle of the corner. Nothing even good.
Take three of them, so I'll take one.
The weight just pulls you over.
Well, that's the deal there. Once gravity gets a hold of you, it tends not to want to let the bucket come back, and the water doesn't have much to say about it. When the crew are in there, they're just dead weight, and as gravity's throwing them out, it takes the sled the wrong way. And so much of the art of being a brakeman, John, is not about the push. When you're in the sled, you've got to be fluid, and like a motorcycle passenger, you can really detrimentally affect the balance of the sled if you're going the wrong way, if you're zagging.
It's not at this stage, though. You find that there's nobody in that sled that had any kind of an experience. Everybody in that sled's got the experience to stay, to know what they have to do.
The point is, when it goes over, the weight of the bodies takes the sled away from the driver's control.
Well, the driver had no control of that. As like Holcomb just said, that thing rolled into the curve. Weird. I said it from right off the bat. That was a weird, you know, he looked like he was on the take-on, maybe he got on the take-on too early. Now, if you remember at the Olympics last year, Justin Cripps looked like he had a perfect line in four-man and all of a sudden rolled under the curve. Now watch, he's on the take-on perfectly. Now he comes over, does he hit there too early on the right side? Maybe, you know, if we matched up some sleds, he might have got on too early.
Climbs too high, doesn't it? It just goes
straight up that wall.
He pulls off.
He might have got on in the crossover. He might have just said, I got to get over here. Now remember, he just watched two sleds crash there. Yeah. And he wanted to get over. I think he got over too early, and the pressure point just threw him upside down.
Generally, there's two ways you'll crash, steering too little or steering too much. And that looked just like he wasn't steering quite enough to hold the line. On a crazy afternoon in Lake Placid, the four-man bobsled season opener continues. We've had three major crashes now in this second heat after just one in the first heat. And the latest to go over, junior world champion Francesco Friedrich of Germany. Steve Holcomb, the race leader, explaining how he made exactly the same error 4 or 5 years ago in the transition. The fast change between 8 and 9. It's Holcomb there on the right who leads the race with six to go.
And you must also remember that the guy who just crashed won the two-man event yesterday. So the track, four of the 17 sleds in the field have crashed. Although Max Arndt did go across the finish line, he'll get a result. He won't get a DNF. But Brazil, Korea, and Germany 3 are all DNFs.
Mm.
And we got six to go.
The last crash was right in front of a Russian sled. This crash, right in front of a Russian sled. And were the Russians put off? No, they started faster than their first run. And these guys are going to do exactly the same.
Okay, here we go. Zakharov told the story in the first heat that this Russian knocked the USA out of having three four-man teams in the Olympics. He came out of nowhere last year. The race that qualified Russia at three sleds in the game from the US only two was right here. Zakharov came from the 24th position, ended up in the top 10, and he went to the games. Curve eight, there's the problem. Look at the way he that nose dove out of there.
Got a big steer in to make sure it didn't go the wrong way up out of turn nine. Now he's on target. Now he can focus on the rest of the run and keeping the speed on the sled. Look at the chicane, little skid, 124.
Right to the 100. That's a mistake there.
Gonna be behind.
Late.
Oh, won't find any more speed. He'll be 1,500s behind maybe at the line because it's uphill through the heart to the finish line. 1,100s back. Holcomb leads, but a little ripple of applause for Nikita Zakharov, bringing the crew down without the use of their helmets on the ice.
So did Zakharov have a bad heat, or did Holcomb have a real good heat like he should have had?
Holcomb had a good second heat, definitely.
He had good speed all the way up through the exit of Shady and then the chicane. Now watch this skid. This is, watch the way that sled grabs in the curve here. Look at the way the head snapped that transition on the take on.
Attention, clear the track.
That's
the track
where he lost a lot of time at the high speed part of the track.
Well, Zakharov over a third of a second slower than his first run gave away the spot to Holcomb. Justin Cripps of Canada, fast emerging as their star driver. Tim Randall, Brian Barnett, and Ben Coakwell, fourth place for Cripps, tied for fourth, just 500s away from a World Cup medal to start the season.
Third best start, 5:05 in the first run. 5:06 speed on the left. 54.5, 33.9 miles an hour. That's about a half of, about 3/10 of a mile an hour better than Holcomb's speed there at the start. He's got 4/10 on Holcomb. The only way he's not going to be the leader at the bottom, if curve eight eats him up. Right there, he's, oh, he got through there.
But well, now he's not looking behind him at Holcomb.
He's
this is to
medal.
Grab a medal, absolutely.
It's the energy here. Nice. Runner tips coming into your picture. Look at him. Not bad.
Speed. Good speed.
Look at the hands. Perfect. Justin Cripps. Oh, he's lost a lot back to Holcomb here in the bottom, but he's in first.
Might rule him out of a medal position, though. Four sleds covered by 1600s. You can't afford much of a mistake. 55 flat. That's the fastest run of the second heat so far. That is just under half a second slower than his first run, though. The track is definitely not as fast as it was earlier.
Rising star in this sport right there. The slingshot effect in Shady. You want to hit this and just launch yourself from the bottom part of the track. Look at the heads. Look at the G-force. Perfect exit. Look at the runner tips. But he only had the eighth best time on the exit, but all them sleds went a lot earlier than he did. This track's slowing up.
Justin Cripps of Canada, heading off, passing Steve Holcomb into the leader's box. Four sleds to go. We had five covered by 1600s. And the first of the next four is Nick Cunningham of the USA. Took bronze medal yesterday in the two-man race, was the joint leader after heat one. Let's see if he can take another medal here in Lake Placid.
Tied after the first heat with the Canadian Justin Cripps, who's now in the leader's box.
All right, here we go. Come on now.
Everything you boys got.
Come on.
He needs a 505. Ooh, a little late. One of the crewmen not getting it perfectly. 506. Watch the speed out here in the left. 54.2. That's a 6/10 of a kilometer down to Justin Cripps. So he's going to need a perfect run to overtake Cripps in the bottom here.
Ran over a spectator's hat in the final corner yesterday, which perhaps robbed him of a chance for a silver medal. He's behind Cripps.
13, need some more time. This is the night train that won the World Championships on this track in 2009 and won the Olympic gold medal in Vancouver in 2010. No speed, though. He's going to drop a couple spots.
Cripps 124.6, Cunningham 123.9 there, 2 tenths back. He's still in second spot, but there are still 3 sleds to come. And at the line, he remains in second position in front of Steve Holcomb by 0.07 of a second in Holkey's old sled. Justin Cripps has the lead with 3 to go. Cunningham may be out of the medals here, but no bets are being taken anymore. 3 sleds to go. No guarantee they're all going to make it down.
Well, we talked about the importance of the start, getting in with cat-like movements and sitting down. These are brand new guys, all working with each other. Cripps' team is almost his Olympic team intact. Watch the left side. See, they had a little collision getting in. Well, they had the exact same start time as Cripps, but they had almost a half a kilometer down on their start speed. So that's the entry into the sled. Then down here, curve 8, look at this. This is where the accidents were. He was a little late, but boy, he got out of 8 just the way he wanted.
Justin Cripps, Nick Cunningham, Stephen Holcomb, your top 3. 3 sleds to go here in Lake Placid. Now we are talking medals. Top 3 sleds covered by just 0.08 of a second. It takes you that long to blink your eye. Alexander Kazyanov first to go for Russia.
Kasanov is tied to the 100th of a second with Mulbardas, the Latvian, coming up. Kasanov had a 5.06 in the first run. 5.05 here. Let's watch the speed of left. 54.6. 54.6. Perfect. Look at the rudder tips. Perfect. Textbook. 4th in both Olympic disciplines last year. He wants to emerge. Never doesn't want to hear that he's Russian number 2 anymore.
Faster speed, 116.9.
Rudder tips. Great speed.
The fastest again, 124.8. Nobody has been quicker in the chicane.
Into the finish.
Pulling away fast. He was 0.08 in front of Justin Cripps. He finishes 0.26 up. That's a big run. That guarantees Kazyanov a medal to start the season.
Alexander Zubkov won double gold for Russia last year's Winter Olympics. This is the new superstar for Russia. He had a coming out party last year, just missed Olympic medals, just put himself on the podium in this first four-man race of the year. Did it with precision at the start, and he carved his way down the track perfectly. Look at the rudder tips there. Look, can you see anybody behind? You see his shoulders bouncing up. Good aerodynamic profile, except for that number 3 guy. Look at the rudder tips. Little bit of variance there.
Tiny little twitch.
Came over with that line.
There's the confidence of Alexander Kazyanov, your race leader, and that is a major challenge. Tied with Kazyanov to the 100th after the first heat. Started 500s quicker, Oscars Melbardis. 5.01 getaway. The Latvians need to drop into the 4s to give him the chance for a gold medal here in Lake Placid.
Go! 5.01 on the first run. This is the Olympic team that won the silver medal at last year's Olympic. 4.96! That start track is faster up there. And this is the silver medalist from last year's Winter Olympics. I love to say the biggest, fastest athletes in the United States are in the NFL. The biggest, fastest athletes in Latvia are in this sled. Oh, he's lost it back, though. Good speed.
Same as Kazyanov. No, Kazyanov, 116.9. Kazyanov, 124.8 of the
problems.
Game. 125 for the double
big speed.
Heat. 800's in it. This could be another dead heat. He was tied with Kazyanov after the first heat. After 2 miles of ice, is he in front? Is he behind? Is he tied? No, he goes behind Kasyanov, silver at least.
He had better speed in the Exeter chicane, but those taps down there. So the Olympic silver medalist succumbs to the guy who finished fourth at the Winter Olympic Games.
That was his shot for gold. He missed.
He knows it too. He'll beat himself up. He is a very, very proud athlete. Bang. Look at the tips. Look at the spray coming off the runners. Another hit. Now he's on the wrong side. He's got to come in on the take-on. A lot of pressure on the take-on. That's where he lost it, 300ths of a second.
Our first heat leader, Germany's Max Arndt. Kevin Corona, Joshua Bloom, Ben Haber. This again is pretty much an all-new crew behind Germany's Max Arndt. Leads after the first heat by 800ths of a second. There's Alexander Kasyanov, third from left. And the rest of his crew, they lead now. Are they going to get silver? Are they going to get gold?
This is a four-man specialist, the 2013 world champion in St. Moritz, fifth at the Olympic Games last year. If there's any deficiency about this German team, it's in the start time, 5:09, the ninth best start in the first heat. They should be better than that, 5:07. Speed, about 54.3 or 4, 54.7. That tells you how good of a load this team had into the sled. Deficient start to the Latvians and Russians almost equaled their start speed.
600ths up as he sat down, 1/100th of a second as he gets into the Devil's Highway. Is it enough for Max Arndt to come back?
Plus 7. Now, this is where this magical hands and eyes that he has takes over. Speed.
Slower than Kasyanov by 0.7 of a kilometer now. The gap grows to 800ths. 125.2, quicker than the Russian. Here we go. This is where Arndt has got to dig for gold.
This is close.
Through the heart. 500ths behind and at the line. Gold for Germany.
Magical.
100ths of a second.
He's a magical guy. He's a speed merchant. He found that. He was down by 800ths with 250 meters to go.
Excellent. Same. Germany win gold in the two-man. Germany win gold in the four-man after failing even to get the motor started in bobsledding in Sochi. Wow. The rebuilding is starting with a bang for the German bobsled program. Yesterday, Francesco Friedrich took gold in the two-man. Today, Max Arndt takes gold in the four-man. It's a big two thumbs up for Maximilian Arndt. A 54.89 slide from him, the slowest of the top three, but he wins it by 1/100th of a second. 1/100th of a second at 75 miles an hour is about a foot and change. That is the tiniest amount. Takes around 7 or 8 hundredths of a second for you to blink your eyes fast. There you see Kasyanov and his crew offering their congratulations. When you're in a race this tight, the difference between win, lose, and draw is insanely close. Well, there is a very happy Max Arndt and a very happy crew. They didn't outstart the Latvians. They were 1,100 slower at the start than Latvia. They were 200 slower than Russia, but they beat them all in the drive. And below the chicane is where Max Arndt found that gold. He went to the heart and came back with the gold medal. Stunning last three corners from Max Arndt to what sealed it at the end of a stellar drive. He led heat one, he led heat two, and won it at the line. Dipped to take the medal by 1/100th of a second. Look at that, top three covered by 0.04 of a second. Max Arndt takes gold, Alexander Kasyanov takes silver, and Oscars Malbardis takes the bronze. Justin Cripps, Nick Cunningham, and Stephen Holcomb rounding out the top half dozen. And Cody Baskew, the American rookie, ninth place on his four-man World Cup debut.
So Max Arndt,
what a race he has produced. Alexander Kazyanov, Oskar Melbardis, rounding out the podium. Could have gone any way between those three. And frankly, the way it ended up perhaps was fitting. Max Arndt producing another world champions drive in the four-man. Everybody heading down to the finish area. And down below the finish area, we will get to the Olympic Plaza where the medal presentations will be for the women's bobsleigh, with Alana Myers-Taylor winning for the USA and Max Arndt winning the four-man race for Germany. Don't forget, next weekend we are racing in Calgary, Alberta, men and women's skeleton, men and women's bobsleigh. And the four-man race will make history. For the first time in World Cup history, we will have female drivers as well as male drivers in the four-man contest. Alana Myers-Taylor and Kaylee Humphreys, the top two women in Olympic women's bobsledding, will be taking on all comers in the four-man race. And that is going to be a very interesting dynamic indeed. Temperatures will be a little warmer than here in Lake Placid, hovering around -1, +1 when we get to Calgary. So it should be a great race weekend. Max Arndt of Germany leads the World Cup rankings. Winner of the first race of the season here in Lake Placid from Alexander Kazyanov of Russia and Oskar Melbardis of Latvia. Justin Cripps, Nick Cunningham and Stephen Holcomb for the home side in fourth, fifth and sixth. And Cody Baskew, ninth in World Cup points after his rookie weekend. In a second heat that was indeed a competition that was littered by crashes, no fewer than four in the field. And we had very dramatic scenes of incident and accident and a very dramatic race finish as well. In the end, just 0.04 seconds covered the entire podium. Well, there are your top three. On the deck is John Morgan. Let's hear from our podium finishers.
Yeah.
Okay, we go over.
Well, Max Arndt knew he had it all to do. Massively tight race after the first heat. Top three covered by 0.08 seconds. He saw a big drive from Alexander Kazyanov to see off the threat of Oskar Melbardis. And Arndt needed a top draw drive, and he produced it. He was behind all the way down to the chicane. And then in 17, 18 and 19, in the heart at the end of this track, in the flat and uphill, he found gold to win the first race of the season.
So the silver SUV parked at the upper.
Let's get down to the finish dock and catch up with John Morgan with our top three.
It's my car.
Needs to be moved.
It's my car.
Okay, Oskar Melbardis. Bronze medal. Happy.
Yeah, we are very happy, and this is, after this week, I can say this is my favorite track, and I want to say big thanks to track workers for great week. Track was in good condition. Thank you.
Again, congratulations, Latvia. Good way to start the season. Over to Team Kasanov. Good start time. Good result.
Да, хороший старт, неплохой финиш. Все нормально. Новый сезон. Давайте ждите нас, смотрите. Все хорошо.
He's a pretty proud athlete, and he says that he had a good start time, a good finish, and a good way to start the season. Congratulations, Russia. Hey. Oh, Team Max Arndt. You crashed here earlier in the week. Two of your German teammates crashed. And then the bottom part of the track, you find a way to win by 1/100. What is your feeling about this place?
Yeah, it was a perfect day, first place, so crazy with this fucking crazy guys. Nate makes fun today. We have a crash on Monday, so I try to make it better today. Then I see my teammates crash. I hope all okay. And then I have to concentrate on the top. The boys are starting great in the second round. And then on the down part of the track, I find a good line, and then it's a win. I'm happy, really happy.
Great way to start the season. Great way to find the time on the bottom. Congratulations to all the teams.
Podium full of smiles, and only Latvia's Oskars Melbārdis was on the two-man podium yesterday, taking the silver medal. No wonder this is his new favorite track. Max Arndt kicks off the season with victory, and we reconvene Friday, Saturday next week in Calgary, Alberta, Canada, the 76th Winter Olympic track, as we take on the action for men and women skeleton, the two-man, the women's bob, and the four-man, featuring two women competitors. Join us then for the moment from Lake Placid. Thanks for being with us. Goodbye for now.